Hello, Neuro-otology viewers. Today we are diving in a fascinating topic, how vestibular migraine works. We will explore the underlying mechanisms and what causes its symptoms to develop. Let's get started. One of the most crucial mechanisms of vestibular migraine is activation of trigeminal cervical system. The trigeminal nerve is one of the largest nerves in the head and plays a key role in migraines. It affects not only the face and head, but also the meninges around the brain and the blood vessels. The first step in a migraine episode is something called cortical spreading depression, which is a wave of electrical activity in the brain. This wave then activates the trigeminal system, leading to changes in the brain's meninges and the upper neck area. The activation of a trigeminal cervical system leads to a kind of chemical aseptic inflammation. This inflammation is driven by pro-inflammatory chemicals released by the system, causing irritation around the nerves and blood vessels and creating a cycle that intensifies the headache and dizziness. As we discuss vestibular migraine, it's important to highlight the role of the thalamus, a crucial brain structure in this process. The thalamus is a central brain structure that acts as a relay station between the brainstem and the cortex, transmitting all the sensory information except for smell to the cortex for processing. Another crucial structure involved in the process of vestibular migraine is the hypothalamus. This small structure located just below the thalamus is responsible for regulating autonomic functions such as the sleep cycle, hunger, body temperature, digestion, heart rate, and blood pressure. The trigeminal cervical system is closely linked to various components of the vestibular system: the brainstem, the cerebellum, the thalamus, the hypothalamus, and the cortex. When abnormal electrical activity spreads between the vestibular and trigeminal pathways, it leads to the vestibular symptoms that are characteristic of vestibular migraine. All right, now let's move on to the diagram of the trigeminal cervical system so I can show you the anatomical connections and relationships we've talked about so far. Let's start with a quick legend for the diagram. BR stands for brain. CE for cerebellum, B for brainstem, C for cerebral cortex, and TJ for the trigeminal ganglion. The greater occipital nerve and the spinal nerves C1, C2, and C3 are shown in green. The thalamus and hypothalamus are shown in blue, and all the structures of the trigeminal nerve are highlighted in red. The ophthalmic nerve is V1. The maxillary nerve is V2 and the mandibular nerve is V3. So the trigeminal nerve has a very extensive network of nuclei that start in the brainstem, including the midbrain, pons, and medulla oblongata, and it extends down to the upper spinal cord. It's quite long and transverses several structures. The sensory trigeminal nerve nuclei are the largest of the cranial nerve nuclei. The small red dots on the diagram represent these nuclei. The nerve fibers from these nuclei come together and form the trigeminal ganglion just beyond the brainstem, which acts as a major relay station. After that, the trigeminal nerve splits into three branches: the ophthalmic nerve V1, the maxillary nerve V2, and the mandibular nerve V3. The trigeminal nerve, also known as cranial nerve 5, is the main sensory nerve of the face and also controls some chewing muscles. It has three major branches. The ophthalmic nerve provides sensation to the forehead, scalp, upper eyelids, and the nose. The maxillary nerve covers the lower eyelid, cheeks, upper lip, upper teeth, and the palate. The mandibular nerve, which has both sensory and motor functions, covers the lower lip, chin, lower teeth, and parts of the tongue. And it also controls the muscles of mastication. The ophthalmic nerve, or V1, does give off meningeal branches that supply the meninges, the protective layers around the brain. These meningeal branches can indeed interact with the greater occipital nerve, which comes from the cervical spine. This connection is part of what's known as the trigeminal cervical complex and it can play a role in conditions like vestibular migraine. Let's now focus on the spinal nerves, specifically C1, C2 and C3, which originate from the upper spinal cord. On the diagram, you can see how these spinal nerves closely interact with the lower nuclei of a trigeminal nerve. This connection is part of what we call the trigeminal cervical complex. Additionally, from these spinal nerves, the greater occipital nerve is formed, which innervates the back of the head and neck. This nerve then meets up with the meningeal branches of the ophthalmic nerve in the upper part of the head, creating the key interaction points, one at the upper spinal cord and another at the top of the head. Together, they form the trigeminal cervical complex. There is also a third interaction between the trigeminal system and the greater occipital nerve, specifically from the upper part of the brainstem, sensory pathways project to the thalamus, and from the thalamus, the signals are relayed to the hypothalamus and to the cortex. It's important to note that all sensory inputs except for smell are processed through the thalamus, which plays a crucial role in vestibular migraine. All right, viewers of Neurotology channel, that's all for now. I hope you've gained a clear understanding of the trigeminal cervical complex. We'll definitely revisit this structure many times in future episodes as we dive deeper into vestibular migraine. Until then, take care and thank you for watching.